First up, I'm going to keep this brief. I'm not going to do this subject the justice that could really be put into it, the research and all the rest of it. This is about Aboriginal people, Aboriginal sort of secret societies, if you will, and magic, basically. There's a book being written, Aboriginal Men of High Degree, Initiation and Sorcery in the World's Oldest Tradition. I've read that. Let's read something from the journals of John McDougall Stewart. And just reading, one was an old man and seemed to be the father of these two fine young men. He was very talkative. Now, this is an interaction I'm reading here, an interaction between a settler to Australia and the original people, the Aboriginal people. So this man, he was very talkative, but I could make nothing of him. I endeavoured by signs to get information from him as to where the next water is, but we cannot understand each other. After some time, and having conferred with his sons, he turned around and surprised me by giving one of the Masonic signs. I looked at him steadily. He repeated it, and so did his two sons. I then returned it, which seemed to please them much. The old man patted me on the shoulder and stroked down my beard. They then took their departure, making friendly signs until they were out of sight. Similarities have been made by Masons regarding Aboriginal aspects, including you would have the pedestals in the lodge, for example. Here they've got use of fires north, south and west, craft pedestal lights, aprons. We have the blindfold there, the veil, mention of veil and burning bush, many things. The Axis Mundi, the pole, the Axis Mundi with the rings featured on it, Bora circles and Bora ceremonies. Let's now have a look within this book titled Wisdom from the Earth. Here we have an illustration and the snake through here. You can kind of see that the snake is a portal in a way, also the tree of life going through here and further aspects. In the caption down here, Wungud is the name of the snake, the earth snake, and we have writing here regarding creation. Here described as female, although in the caption over here we also have further reference and reference to the rainbow serpent also, and reference to both female and male through here. I don't want to dwell on things, let's keep going. Further within here we have talk of spirit beings. These spirit beings not only made everything, but they also gave plants and animals their names and distinctive markings. Aboriginal people have the sacred fire, the eternal flame. The Wanjina is a spirit entity that the Aboriginal people depict. And here is one here with this halo-like piece around the head right here of light. This depiction here, of course, very interesting. We can see the caption here, but of course within here, you have this kind of level up here, the tree of life going up through here with the two figures aside the tree of life. You can see this kind of all over the world. Lightning spirits from Arnhem Land in the top of Australia. And here is a depiction of lightning spirits. And once again, you can see familiarities here. In regards to this image right here, this illustration, you can see the moon up there and various other aspects. We have Sun Woman and Moon Man. Now you will often kind of see the male and female around the other way, but Moon Man and Eternal Life by Paddy Fordham, Wayne Bunga. Of the Rembaranga people is the story about why Aboriginal people turn into their totems when they die so that their spirit lives on. So people are turning into pillars here. Here we have a depiction, a further depiction of a Wanjina right here. And reading over this way, we can read, Wangina rock paintings tend to share various features in common. Their heads are large and dominated by staring black eyes that at times resemble those of an owl. And interestingly, Dumbi, the owl, is associated with the Wangina figures in the Ngarinyan story of Wana Liri, as Mururu has written. Let's do some further reading. The concept of earth or land in traditional Aboriginal cosmography is more extended than in European-based cultures. It appears that in most, if not all, regional groups across Australia, a broadly similar worldview developed in relation to the created world bequeathed by Dreamtime spirit ancestors. The earth was perceived as flat and circular, with a concave sphere of the sky stretching down to the horizon in all directions. But the sky was also a type of earth as well, and many ancestral beings and cultural heroes lived there. It was a land with a plentiful water supply, and the stars in the sky were the campfires of the spirit ancestors and heroes who dwelt in that realm. Beneath our own earth, too, was an underworld populated by people and spirits much like ourselves. The afterlife is also believed to be a shadowy facsimile of this earth plane. Whatever happens in this world also has resonances in the spirit world. There are no divisions. The entire landscape is viewed as one mighty arena in which the events of the Dreamtime creation unfolded. Thus, the cosmogonic earth is seen as a sacred icon of great beauty, immense power, and profound mystery, inspiring great awe and respect. Furs Morris talks about emanation from the hand, etheric emanation, and it's interesting to see the fields around some of the hands portrayed on the rock art, the Aboriginal rock art. I'm now going to read further within this page right here. Elements of the earth. Many Aboriginal myths divide the land into two different elements, each an ancestral spirit with its own history and personality. Earth is considered primary, and from it water must be liberated. This is the second element. From water, the third element, fire, must be released. And from it in turn, and symbolized by the smoke of a campfire, air comes forth. Earth, water, fire, and air. Earth and water are considered to be female, and men must take special precautions when engaging with them, for the male spirit ancestors were born from them. Fire and air are incorporated in male initiatory rites, for example, in the Bora circles, the sacred ritual spaces of Aboriginal ceremonial grounds. In male initiations, the candidate must pass through fire and then be purified by smoking, a purificatory ritual carried out on other occasions. However, fire originally belonged to female ancestors and symbolizes their warmth and light. These ancestors either gave or had their fire stolen by a male ancestor, such as the crow. Now, the notion of fire being stolen would perhaps remind one of Prometheus also. So to backtrack, these ancestors either gave or had their fire stolen by a male ancestor, such as a crow. He then keeps it for himself, so somehow it has to be taken back from him. There are many stories about the original making of fire and the stealing of fire in Aboriginal mythology. In Arnhem Land, ancestral women were the possessors of fire until it was stolen from them by their sons, who became crocodiles. They in turn kept fire for themselves until it was retrieved by the rainbow bird, who gave it to everyone. Just a couple of things to note here, that the sons became crocodiles. Now that, in a way, would indicate a kind of shapeshift, but I would suggest probably an etheric shapeshift, if you will. Further, the rainbow bird would be a bird of a portal, a light portal, I would suggest. Just to read on further, the sacred colours of the earth are red, black, yellow, and white. These were given to the Aboriginal peoples during the dream time and also feature in the Aboriginal national flag except for the white. The sacred colours of the earth are red, black, yellow, and white. These were given to the Aboriginal peoples during the dream time. Before I read on, let's note the word dream time and what could that word really relate to, because various Aboriginal people engage in rituals, magic rituals, if you will. But let's keep reading. Red is the colour of blood, energy, and fire, and represents the spiritual energy which connects all Aboriginals in the dream time and is found in potent locations within the earth. It can also represent death. Black is symbolic of earth itself, but is also associated with the marks left upon the land when the spirit ancestors made their campfires upon the earth during the dream time. Associations and applications vary in different regions, but other examples are as follows. Yellow represents liquids, and water in particular, as well as the markings upon the back of the ancestral rainbow serpent, and white is the sacred colour of the sky, the air, and the stars. It is also the colour of the spirit ancestors who ascended to the heavens after their work was done on earth during the dream time. Reading further, similarly, underwater formations and the earth's minerals are considered aspects left behind by spirit ancestors at particular locations and as such have value which is spiritual rather than material. Among the most important of the minerals are ochre and quartz crystals. Ochre or iron oxide is the most important pigment used for body painting and more latterly in art making. Ochre comes in a range of colours from white and yellow through to red and brown. In Aboriginal ritual life, red ochre or wiltja is the most sacred of all colours. In parts of Central Australia, it is associated with the blood shed by the dog Morindi, who died when he fought the gecko lizard Ando Atena. The blood of Morindi became the site of an important red ochre deposit situated at Parachilna in South Australia. The Adnyamathanha elders tell how in the Flinders Ranges in South Australia there lived a gecko lizard named Ando Atena. Within the story by the elders, we can see reference here to a magic string around the tail, among other aspects. Here we have part of a ritual going on here, and we have reference here to song lines, music and dance, and I'll just read a little from within here. Songline, music and dance. From an Aboriginal perspective, the Australian continent is literally enmeshed and crisscrossed with a variety of sacred sites and their accompanying mythic songs, stories and meanings. This mnemonic songline mapping constitutes the creative journeys of the spirit ancestors and the markings of specific locations where the spirit ancestors first arose from the earth, ascending to the sky, came ashore from across the seas, engaged in intensely creative acts, and where they later departed to seek the rest of their conclusion of their divine creation. These sites, as we have mentioned, are known as strong energy source places, or Dajang, Wungud, or Malagi places, according to regional languages. They are believed to contain powerful spiritual energy or spirit essence bestowed and sanctified by the spirit ancestors, which can be drawn upon and recharged through ritual activity. These sites are like electrical sockets or high energy points in a grid system, and can be joined up like dotted drawings shown in the song lines of the ancestors. The mapping of sacred sites and song lines was also one of encoding divine law. These regional areas are connected to other regional areas, some of which may contain continuing aspects of a dreaming track or paths of ancestral journeying. So there are mutual obligations inherent in this knowledge. An ancestral songline or song cycle may traverse thousands of kilometers across several language areas. Each song in a cycle, which signifies an action of an ancestral being in a specific place, is owned and is the responsibility of an Aboriginal person who is the custodian of the dreaming of that place. Each custodian has been taught the procedures of her or his duty of care to the land, and they expect that all other Aboriginal custodians of a dreaming track would similarly carry out their roles. For a dreaming track or songline connects all of those who share this dreaming or knowledge it contains. The whole cycle had to be completed by each in turn at a specific site. The emission of one song of a cycle would literally make a hole in the songline. With this interdependence and execution of individual and collective responsibility, the health of peoples and land was maintained, for they were seen as inseparable. This picture here, within this photograph here, we can see a men's ceremony. Just a couple of things, among other things, but you have the kind of tree here, the people as trees, and also the pillars atop the head also. So the people, the pillars, the trees, they all tie into one basically. Here we have a woman's ceremony. And notably here, among other aspects, you can see the pillars here, the Jukin and Boaz-like pillars depicted with the kind of mage, if you will, in the center. And you can see the fields around the pillar right there. These kind of pillars, trees of life, if you will. Representing etheric columns, I would suggest. Ritual and ceremony. The Bora Ground. In some parts of Australia, the meeting place for sacred ceremonies is known as a Bora Ground or Bora Ring, especially in New South Wales, South Queensland, and the Gippsland area of Victoria. The word Bora is a Kamilaroi term which describes a fur-string belt, the belt of manhood, which was worn traditionally by men initiated into the sacred cult of Biami. Here in this depiction, which is a woman's ceremony, you again can see the, what I would suggest are fields around the central pillar with the rings on the pillar also, the pillar of foliage, the central etheric pillar right here, I would suggest. This depiction here regards an Aboriginal ceremony, and we can see the writing about that right here. Performing a ritual. A Kunapipi ritual complex which immigrated to the Oenpeli area of Western Arnhem Land included protective magic for women and men experiencing the rites for the first time. The spirit of a snake or a small parrot was sung onto the back of their heads so that it could warn them should anyone stealthily attempt to work sorcery upon them or to spear them in the back. Although the Kunapipi has a certain fluidity, its basic core remains constant, with much the same sacred objects, myths, songs, and ritual sequences. Within the text just read, you may have noticed that the spirit of a snake and small parrot was sung onto the back of the ritual participant as a guardian spirit. The notion of animal spirits in the ritual situation is a whole topic in itself. Just to relate a story from an occultist I met, this particular occultist got angry at me at the notion of the general public knowing about the occult. He was relating that he was in a store in Sydney. There were occultists running the store, and as he left, they attached a spirit to him. And he was pissed off about this, basically, and said that he had to go about getting rid of that particular spirit. Ceremony and secret business, women's and men's. Again, another depiction here with that pillar, the rings on the pillar, the rings around here also, the fields, the tree of life there. another depiction of a men's ceremony. We saw this earlier on, the pillars, the headwear there, a men's ceremony. There's so much I haven't covered. I haven't done this subject justice. This is just a small taste of the occult side to Aboriginal culture. I'll make a quick follow-up vid to this one. Check for the link in the description box.